gathered together here, some of his outlaws, was his teacher and his friend and his colleague. Gary Shapiro was his friend, as was Babette was his student and colleague and co-founder of teacher studies with him. And Tim Hyde was his student, friend, and colleague, coming to us specially from London, gloriously sartorial attack, as usual. I was his friend. Each of us will have something of varying lengths to say, and some of it substantive, and some of it in memoriam. I think we start with the order here, which is Sal.
One thing to note is that this is being recorded in particular for David Allison's family as well. So that's one of the reasons that this is sort of more than just here. And so that's also another way of talking about it. Time, space, space, just to keep that in mind.
We mourn the death back in July of David Allison. With a Fulbright degree in Paris, David earned a PhD from Pennsylvania State University in 1974. He then joined the faculty at Stony Brook, where he taught until his retirement in 2013. He died at the age of 72. He is survived by his wife, Helen, daughter, Mary, and granddaughter, Allison. David Allison published Reading the New Nietzsche, and Disordered Mother or Disordered Diagnosis, Munchausen by Proxy Syndrome, co-author with Mark Roberts. He translated Speech and Phenomenon and Other Essays by Jacques Derrida. He is the editor of the New Nietzsche, Psychosis and Sexual Identity Toward a Post-Analytic View of the Schrager Case, Solid in the Narrative of Transgression, and the Journal of New Nietzsche Studies. Published some 50 chapters in books and journal articles, and presented papers at SPAP and in many other venues. And David Allison was very drawn to Nietzsche, to his thought, and also to his life, which we know are so intimately interwoven that one could hardly be drawn to his work without being drawn to Nietzsche's conception of how life should be lived. However, David did not live his life solitary, as Nietzsche did. David did his undergraduate work at the University of Montana at Missoula. He loved the West and loved cars. He explained to me how to quickly get across the 400 miles of cornfields that is Kansas. You notice that dude ahead driving 70. You pass him squealing your tires. He pushes out on the accelerator and passes you doing 75. Then you pass him doing 80. He passes you doing 85. You let him win. 20 miles down the road, you see him pulled over by the state trooper. He will then be occupying for 15 minutes as you speed across the state to Haiti. The year after I joined the Penn State faculty, Dave arrived in the graduate program. In the spring, I found and rented a small old house in an alley that had three layers of old linoleum on the floors. I pulled up the linoleum and then sanded the floors and covered them with three coats of a product called Fabulon, which is a plastic varnish used in bowling alleys. Then I left for the summer, leaving Dave to take the house and take care of my parrot, and party. The partying was so intense that when I returned, all the glasses and all the dishes were broken, and the dancing so wild that Dave had re-sanded and re-varnished the floors. Years later, at Stony Brook, Dave bought a big old house for the big yard on Long Island and had 4th of July parties where they played croquet. When his old friends from Penn State arrived, we declared we would not play croquet unless it was strip croquet. Dave had a tender heart for little people. He was very fond of my parrot, whose name was first Parrot K with a capital P, and later became Wazo with a capital O. Wazo had a wary and suspicious nature, and hardly anyone earned his trust. But one day, Wazo suddenly became very excited and flew to the door, having seen Dave from the window, and flew on Dave's shoulder as soon as the door opened. That was long after Dave had been in Stony Brook, and Wazo had not seen Dave for 12 years. Dave won a Fulbright for Paris, where he indulged his love for all he saw and heard. A model agency saw him, and he raised extra money by being photographed, and his handsome face, with that rascally compulsion ready to break out of his eyes and the edge of his mouth, appeared on billboards here and there across France. The summer before he began teaching, Dave went to the Amazon and was body painted by some Amazonian people and came back with spears and a jaguar skull. At Stony Brook, Dave founded a junior year abroad program in romantic Paris, in romantic France. And for a number of years, found he had been there himself to arrange accommodations for the students and abortions. Dave was a founder of the Nietzsche Society, and planning the first meeting, we agreed that it should take place somewhere high in the Rocky Mountains, and that members should identify and greet one another with secret signals like Freemasons. The main speaker would be the author of My Sister and I, who would appear masked, read his paper, take no questions, and immediately leave in a waiting cab. In Paris, Dave stayed in the garret room in a building that still belonged to the family of the Marquis de Sade. He organized and hosted a meeting devoted to the Marquis of Sade at Stony Brook. He was able to host it in the mansion donated to Stony Brook by the owner of the Tom McCann Shoe Company. You know the mansions donated to the universities become lifeless and cold, and this one was at the end of an isolated road on a deserted rocky beach, so it did have the right atmospheres, particularly for shoe fetishists. Dave organized a meeting dedicated to the memoirs of my nervous illness by 19th century judge Daniel Paul Schreiber. At the meeting, a very respected psychoanalyst debated whether Freud's diagnosis that Schreiber was a conflicted homosexual suffering from paranoid schizophrenia was correct. One of the philosophers found Schreiber to be a penetrating and original thinker and wondered whether Schreiber's memoir should be read simply as a work of empirical psychology or a work of literature. Then Morton Schatzman discovered that Schreiber's father was a cruel disciplinarian who invented a number of contraptions in which he strapped young Daniel Paul to prevent him from masturbating. So the colleague attention shifted to him, which Schreiber's father was a real bad one. And then researchers discovered that Dr. Fletcher, the doctor of the asylum where Schreiber was a patient, had the strangest ideas and the weirdest practice. Schreiber was sane compared to Dr. Fletcher. Then it was discovered that Schreiber's wife had Schreiber incarcerated in the asylum to prevent him from discovering that she was having an affair with Dr. Fletcher. So it was all her fault. Then Dave began distributing bumper stickers to everybody with the words "Free Daniel Paul Schreiber." There were so many sides to Dave: libertine, father, bloke, sophisticate, gardener, yachtsman, reformer, skeptic, and there were also many sides to his intellect. At Penn State, there were compulsory comprehensive exams in medieval philosophy, which most graduate students suffered through. But Dave got fascinated with the epistemologies and metaphysics woven into the different medieval heretics and schismatics. He delighted in the interpretation of Descartes, and at the end still hoped to finish a book on Descartes. He translated Derrida and followed French structuralism. And also, he followed punctiliously the minute distinctions and various advances of Husserl's logical mind. People who attended his classes found themselves informed, educated, refined, broadened. And for us outside of his classes, conversation with Dave, excited, enlightened, and entertained. There's my immense gratitude for having known David Ellison. From the year that he arrived in the graduate program at Penn State, and for decades after, there was no one whose sympathetic and critical conversation shaped, directed, corrected, and encouraged my thinking like Dave Ellison. He was the most generous person I ever knew. In conversation, he readily committed himself to exploring philosophical issues with penetration and originality, eager to understand and follow someone else's concerns. He was a legendary raconteur, loved language, had a lightning quick wit. How many times late at night I was on the floor holding my gut and hurting from so much laughter as he raced on. Dave Allison was very, very much loved. I would like to express our affection for Ellen, Dave's wife, editor Dave's most important publisher of Rock Books, and their daughter Mary, a medical doctor, and their granddaughter, granddaughter, Mary's daughter, Allison, who had now 17 months, and Ellen wrote me, she, Ellen, hopes will remember that she, Allison, was the principal pleasure they found at the end of his suffering.
Polish history. Well, by this time, Al and I and I believe David too, as a result of our dinner extras, were in total laughter and very difficult to control ourselves and be socially responsible. So I think of David in that light. I came to know David later, but not as intimately as I think the others here. Always respected his intelligence, his generosity. I remember one time I had to get a reference for a friend. I thought, who would know this? We needed to know the exact passage and page number of a quotation from Heidegger's Nietzsche that we were searching for, and it had to be done right away to meet a publication deadline. Somehow I had David's number, called him up on Long Island. There he was, dropped whatever it was he was doing, ran to the bookshelf, got down the thing that we needed, gave us this reference. So we needed new Nietzsche, the new Nietzsche. We needed new Nietzsche studies that Babette has contributed so much to. Actually, I don't have time to talk about it now, but I will, because there's going to be a session on Babette's work later in the conference. I want to say something about historically what it meant in the United States to Nietzsche studies, maybe to philosophy more generally, that we got both the new Nietzsche and new Nietzsche studies at the times that we did. So, as I say, I was always in a little bit awe of David and his aura, his charm, his intelligence. That's what I have to say.
Thank you very much. It actually would be inappropriate for me to give this talk without wearing a blue blazer.
Yeah.
Which those of you who know David know he knows more. Of course, this was double-breasted, which can't have everything. Thank you. I first met David in person some 15 years ago, and I was introduced to him by Babette. We were then newly married, and she took pains to introduce me to those who had been important to her. Upon meeting David, it was not hard to see why that had been the case. I had known, as Gary had, David's work independently, as also from things that in subsequent years before I met him, Babette mentioned to me. Others have, or will, speak more of their personal relations with David. Suffice it for me to say here that he was generous with his learning, sharing of his knowledge, fun to be with, an extraordinary consumer of oysters, and possessed of a particular, if unexplainable, fondness for skirt steak. You'd go to his house, let's put a skirt steak on the barbecue, and come off tough and awful guys. I would rather speak briefly here, I wish to speak briefly here about him as a scholar. I encountered this in several ways. First, though this may seem to be lesser, it is in fact revelatory of everything, but during the years I was editor of the Journal of Political Theory, I would occasionally receive submissions for which I thought him to be the appropriate referee. My procedure was pretty standard. For those submissions I thought I needed other outside advice, I would send to someone I thought or who I knew might actually have something to say about the topic in question. In turn, after the referee would respond, I would send those remarks to the author with some kind of decision. Typically, a referee says something like, this is great, or this needs work, or perhaps the author should reconsider something X. David's responses were almost always, this is terrible, a disgrace to the profession. It was followed by a set of coherent arguments as to why publishing that piece would hasten the fall of Western, perhaps world civilization. First time I sent his remarks to the author precipitated an extended round of complaints, necessitating a response from me, more complaints, response, questions as to the morality, competence, and intelligence of the reviewer, assurances from me as to his competence, about 10 hours of work. people are not used to being told their work is bad. And David is one of the few people who had the courage, perhaps the insouciance, to say so. And I have to admit that in subsequent instances when I used David as a referee, I bolderized his response, thereby saving myself 8 to 10 hours. In retrospect, I should not have done so. I should also say that he always responded quickly, which was not the usual case. I want to turn now more explicitly to his scholarly interests. If David could be said to have had a life project, it was to destroy the idea of the new Nietzsche. To a degree I cannot spell out here, the selections in the new Nietzsche, that volume with its page and a half introduction, which brought to an Anglophone Nietzsche studies what had been happening elsewhere, mostly in France, though there was the article by Al Lingus, another one by Heidegger, and one, I believe, by Tom Altizer. Some of what David presented had found itself, I should say, in my first book, which appeared about the same time as the new Nietzsche, Nose to Light. But David's volume, which was assembled, and it should be remembered, as a response and a counter to the volume of mostly standard analytic readings that had been edited by Bob Solomon in the Modern Masters series, David's volume reoriented the direction of Nietzsche scholarship in English. Why those articles? What were his concerns? In an article published in Boundary 2, David took on most of the standard readings of Worth of Tragedy. Against a range of commentators, including Paul de Man, David maintained that the often asserted parallel or identity of the Dionysian and the noumenal was wrong, that Nietzsche had in any case no need of the noumenal. The title of the essay is Nietzsche Needs No Noumenon. He asserted that the Dionysian was in fact empirical, and that Nietzsche in the birth was attempting to develop a vocabulary adequate to these claims. And lastly, that what Nietzsche does in effect requires from us a re-examination of our understanding of subjectivity. In doing so, he asserted, and this is a short piece, that the division of Nietzsche's work into the standard three periods is wrong, and that the concerns of the birth remained with him throughout his life. In relation to the question of subjectivity, David even notes that Nietzsche's discussion of Archilochus, this is the poet who writes about abandoning his shield, about his various sexual affairs and so on, that this discussion of Archilochus does not exemplify, as almost everybody argued, a subjective voice, but, and I'm quoting here from David, it exemplifies the important, what he says is, it's the important consideration was not so much the communication of a personal or subjective experience as such, speaking of Archilochus. For however intriguing that might have been, though one is entirely incapable of it, but rather the creation of, in quotes, a musical mood, musikalische Stimmung was the German. All of this takes place over 6 or 7 pages. The next volume of that article happens to be by me. And I'm not sure that I read David's when it came out. This was 1981, and I didn't know at that point who David was. In any case, most of us only read our own pieces in edited volumes. I have been trying to argue the same thing as David did about the birth over the last 10 years. Only when I finally read that article to find that there was already a place marker on those arguments, DBA was right there. And I must note that Babette has been doing wonderful work on Archilochus in Greek philology, again, over the last 5 years. And while I'm loath to urge another footnote on her footnotes are worth a price of separate admission, perhaps it's already there, which would not surprise me. In other words, David got there almost en passant before many of us did. It is worth noting here that we have reason thus to be grateful for David's writing and reading the new Nietzsche, the book, as he was at last able to expand these themes. Now, these considerations helped me to explain another question I've always had about David's interests, at which I greatly regret never having gotten around to asking him about death. illness does come from outside the frame. While we knew he was sick, you never expected. One would have thought that, well, David was fascinated by Descartes, which might seem odd given his work on Nietzsche. One would have thought he would have simply dismissed Descartes. Cartesian rationalism usually drips off our pens as a kind of negative. But I have, however, been privileged to read his lecture in the first three of the Meditations, soon to be published in a volume on hermeneutic philosophy of social science, Levet said it to me. David wrote exceptionally well, by any standard, and certainly by those of professional philosophers. One tends, therefore, to forget just how much footwork went into his published pages. It's therefore really worth reading this lecture. It's a close and detailed and critical reading, always in his own voice, of Descartes that revises substantially the usual understanding. He points out that Descartes is concerned to derive from the necessity of the cogito, for which certainty is the goal, but pays, he, Descartes, pays no attention to the ego, which is itself necessarily historical. This in turn leads him to show, David to show, that the central question in Descartes does not turn around the mind-body opposition of separation, but around a subject-object distinction, division. Why then does Descartes call upon God? I'm just going through his essay. In David's analysis, David requires God as a guarantor for the possibility of knowledge. The argument, which I greatly reduce, goes like this. I know I am a thinking thing. I know this because it is clear and distinct. Importance of these always have been established previously. What is clear and distinct is if something is present to consciousness, which are the truths of cogito, mathematics, and principle of non-contradiction. An omnipowerful God could deceive us about this. Thus, for there to be any clarity about in our knowledge, there must be a non-deceiver God. But a non-deceiver God would have also to be considered as good, not just all-powerful, but good. Which would be why he doesn't deceive us, even though, of course, he could. Eventually, David shows that for Descartes to account for the fact that we have, albeit mistaken, images of the world at all, Descartes needs to posit a faculty, quoting Descartes now, not yet fully known to me. Descartes is thus obliged to allow for an external world that on his own principles he cannot claim to know exists. We cannot be mistaken about a world unless there is one to be mistaken about. There is no need for God there, therefore, no need for the noumenon. Bodies of the world exist. We're back to the empirical status of the Dionysian. And Descartes and Kant later, this is me saying, elaborating on this, tell us what knowledge of the world would be. Different ways, but they don't tell us that there is a world, and that's what we found in Nietzsche. God was a great enemy to David. In this he joins in Nietzsche. Nietzsche was, one might say, not crazy to attribute the ills of the world to Christianity, although Nietzsche may have been a little crazy about that idea. David shares this attribution, but gentleman that he was, except perhaps as a referee, he refrained from being crazy about it. I miss him. Next is Babette Babbage, going back to my other chair.
I'm very grateful to everyone who's here. I'm grateful to all of you, also. And perhaps there will be someone else, because many of you know him, who might want to say something, just if you feel like it. This is actually has a title which is terrible. You shouldn't have a title for eulogistic responses. I mean, everyone doesn't need that. But it's called Unchained Melody. David Ellison is not on Facebook any more than Al Lingus is, but except because of me. Anyway, but I thought David should be, like Al, a public figure. And this is how you get to be a public figure. I made a page for him. I just made it up. I made two for David. He got instant likes, and over the years, a lot of personal messages from people, old high school friends, or college friends. I passed these messages on to David, who was cheerfully uninterested in care. This was part of what made David great, is not caring. He could not care less, as we say in New York. For David, that would be New Jersey English. David never cared about what he called, in my mind, his best phrase, cheap, haunting stuff. That was a giveaway for David, no charge. And I have just arranged to publish an essay, Tracy just referred to it, concluding on Descartes, that essay, concluding the last line, is it fine? David loved those like type, you can find easily. Concluding with what he took to be his best phrase, which he lifted from an old black attendant at a country club, I think it was his boss, where he used to work when he was a kid as a caddy. You is, you is, you is, you ain't. You have to think about that for the next 10 years. David loved English. He loved the language itself. He loved language. He loved French. He loved the logic of the sentence, the force of things, the absurdity, the brilliance, the coherence of the way concepts in context, always in context, would have to hang together. That and all the prejudices and automatic associations that went along with every word we speak. But for David, prepositions, prepositions, inherent in every preposition ever used in any essay, any paragraph, any sentence, remained all his life the enduring hobgoblin of his literary, and I also mean editor's, concern. For David, this included the assumptions and fascinations, as Alan mentioned for us, of medieval logicians, but also Descartes and Heidegger, and not less de Sade, along with the uses and abuses of accusation, prejudice, conviction, and not least pernicious in the case of Sade, or indeed Nietzsche. And one could add, David had an amazing sympathy, that is to say, we've convicted in our minds to Sade of all the things we think we know about him, just as we've convicted in our minds Nietzsche with all the things we think we know. And when someone objects to the things we think we know, we say, yeah, but, and go back to what we think we know, which is what a conviction is. One could add that David, and others have already referred to this, and I think that's really wonderful, an amazing sympathy for the underdog. With David, it was clear that the last thing an overman would ever be was a super skis, skivats, I'm saying that for his family. He abhorred unkindness, so he looked at witchcraft, and more prosaically, more practically for our times, at Münchhausen by proxy syndrome, and he was passionate about it. A syndrome exploited by men at the expense of women, their wives, the mothers of their children, deployed by their lawyers, often to horrific personal costs and venal advantage in child custody cases. That was one of the surprising, most enduring, stunning things about David. He was dedicated to fairness in the sense of fair play and decency in politics and online at the corner drugstore. This meant that he really despised people who squabbled over restaurant bills after a meal shared in the company of one another. For David, if one was a friend during dinner, that friendship, he thought, should extend to a kind of one ray the more, one shade the less, kind of laissez-faire when it came to the bill. Cut your friend a little slack, pay a quarter more than you should. And I wish I could say all of this with Christopher Walken accent, the actor who always reminded me of David. Youthful beauty, Al just told us about that, and enduring cool. Still, the thriftier table companions were uniformly aghast at his expressed disdain. But I think It was really that he just liked the conversation and dropping down to the level of that aforementioned cheap antique stuff was just a drag. I was a student of David's a long, long time ago, and I took his classes not on Nietzsche, but Heidegger's Being and Time, that hooked me on Heidegger for Life, and because David was teaching it, a course on transgression, which was his idea of a good theme for a senior seminar. Really, after all this was David, it was a course on the Marquis de Sade. Pornography read for a seminar, actually pornography read at any sustained assigned length for a course is a tedious business. An insight worth volumes of anyone's philosophy of pornography, even today, as folks try to chase the end of the internet to find the best of the best. But it is, everyone will say this, everyone should say this, really Nietzsche studies that David changed. He was not the first, as Tracy has mentioned, to put out a collection on Nietzsche, but his collection was a game changer. It was worthy of its title. The New Nietzsche was really new, really unparalleled. Nothing like it then, nothing like it since. I recently found myself invited to a conference that then became a book collection on the supposedly new Heidegger. And I used David's book as a kind of criterion, but quickly realized that that book only illustrated how impossible such a standard is. There's no new Nietzsche like the new Nietzsche. There's no new anything like the new Nietzsche. And that, of course, is saying something. Indeed, even David was inspired by the constellation of ideas in his own collection, which meant that he could not think of a better title for his own 2001 book, Reading the New Nietzsche. It's not as if he couldn't think of titles. A Diet of Worms, a posy of hatic rhetoric and beyond good and evil, Nietzsche knows no noumenon. I know some of his titles by heart because I'm still thinking about them. But you know, the real thing about David was that he loved. He loved ideas, and he loved you. He thought, and when he thought with you, it was the adventure in ideas everyone said philosophy would be, and it was, but there was a catch. It only worked, as one discovered a little too late to do anything about it, with David, or with people like David. I'm thinking of Al and his other friends. This love David shared with his students, undergraduate and graduate, and he made no distinction. And many of those students would remain friends, his friends, their friends, for years. Even there, David was amazing. He wasn't just some kind of plaster nice guy, fond of everyone, building some house by the side of the road. This was not a friendship of comradely hail fellow, well met, though he could do that too. Rather, one could, with David, as the Germans say, and he's the only person I have ever met that actually lived the phrase, with David, you knew you could steal horses together. And everything was like that. Chinese food was like that. A glass of wine was like that. Okay, whiskey. But so too, walking down the Boulevard Saint-Michel with him, standing on a quay in the Paris metro, waiting for a train, I think he pulled out the very first gray hair I ever had, to my horror. In my youth, and I admit still, I thought gray hairs were great. He did not think that. And I was just finishing a PhD. Dissertations will do that to you. Or Italy, his birthday year, 1994, in Georgetown's Villa Le Balze in Fiesole, Italy, celebrating Nietzsche's birthday. David was born a century after Nietzsche, 1844-1944. Or his fondness for horrible, horrible French hotels and terrible French steaks. I can say it now, David was too enthusiastic to break it to him in life, but an entrecote, steak frites, I can, well, anyway, for me, Tracy already said, terrible cut. Later, much, much later, we spent holidays together, memorable times, weeks with Tim Hyde. I always invited Al, he didn't come, which he had. Also Gary, also conflicts and so on, Deborah, but it didn't work out. Tracy too. Pina Moneta, Dick Cobb Stevens, and Bill Richardson. And the late Patrick Heelan, who always told me with delight that he was with David and Ellen for their wedding in Paris. It must have been wonderful. But David also had delight in small things. He was unfond of cats. no one is perfect, but he would feed small creatures, mostly birds and deer, gave them apples. I loved that notion, and he loved making clam chowder, not the kind I liked, but his enthusiasm was infectious, and painting portions of his house that I thought he should have passed on to enterprising local workmen. David was beautifully Protestant about such things, and when I visited David and Ellen on the fashionable South Shore, as he would say, just a few houses away from Arthur Danto's summer place, he would show me, we've already heard about this house, the upstairs bathroom floor in the bathroom, which I just wanted to admire for the view on the glorious lawns of his backyard. Other houses on the fashionable South Shore just had standard issue backyards. David had glorious lawns and wooded copses, and one half expected a haha to go with the landscape. He pointed to the bathroom floor, indicating the classically hexagonal New York City apartment-style tiles he had installed himself. I was jealous. Small things also extended to bucking convention. He would smoke conspicuously, casually, underneath no smoking signs in classroom seminars, and there was the very having of an office. David has his walls painted as he pleased, with portraits of philosophers, classic ones and contemporary ones, signed by visiting stars, Derrida, Lyotard, Baudrillard, etc., but painted perfectly madly by students. I once painted my dorm wall, to my suite mate's horror, floor to ceiling, with a crucified Satan figure and some kind of beast. David thought it was great. I think there might be something in the water at Stony Brook, the Michelangelo effect. Like I say, as the Germans say, David could steal horses with you, and would talk you into stealing them for real. This is how a journal got started, partly to help me write for his promotion to full professor, partly for the adventure of it. And this is the story of a friendship and a man, the like of whom I had never met before, and we shall not see again. And that lonely thought is sobering. So long, Dionysus. Godspeed. A word David loved. Godspeed.
Last and certainly not least, from two of us from the Tim Hyde.
Hi. I too have a title. It's boss, neighbor, friend, teacher, mentor, father, figure, and mensch. We're talking a little about all those in this regard today.
Title by Boreas.
That's right. My thoughts today are going to be unabashedly personal. We organized a series of presentations on Dave's work when he retired from Stony Brook in 2013, something like that. Al was there, gave a great one. And there, Lisa and I spoke of his very important work on the Munchausen by proxy syndrome. Dave will never be immortalized for that work, but very few of us really get the chance and really to make a difference in those who are marginalized. And that book made a huge impact. The legal case now is that you can't present the Munchausen by proxy as a syndrome unless you can first prove to the judge it is a syndrome. So it's inadmissible in evidence against women. So it's pretty, it's a little thing. Nobody will remember that in 10 years, but it will still go on protecting women in the course of law. But anyway, as I said, I'm not going to talk about that. Selfishly, I think these are, because there wasn't really a memorial for Dave, so these are partly cathartic to help me continue the process of mourning. I don't entirely promise I'm going to hold it together through all of these. But let me talk just a little bit about when I first met Dave. I first met Dave when I first became a grad student at Stony Brook in 1995. I TA'd for him my very first semester. And who could forget his undergraduate teacher? I mean, just spectacular. His cigarette burning in the chalk tray. Those chalk trays are the perfect size of cigarette, right? And then he'd be lighting up another one, right? And this is long after cigarette smoking was banned in classrooms, of course. You know, and for years, you know, we would walk around some pizzeria in Long Island and somebody would come out and grab Dave and tell him how you changed my life with your class. And of course, I told that to somebody and so I said, so if you take Dave's class, you end up in working in pizzerias? I'm like, well, no, it's just you're more likely to run into somebody on Long Island who took a course from David at pizzeria. Probably lots of lawyers, but it's not kind of thing you run into so many lawyers on Long Island that took Dave's course. But anyway, so he was a tremendous, tremendous influence on all his students, and of course, myself, not least of all. I'd studied a couple of years in Paris, and I studied a couple of years in Berlin before I came to Stony Brook, so I was a little older. And I don't know if it was that reason or not, but Dave and I really seemed to hit it off when I was his TA. It immediately became very kind of working in terms as friends. And I remember he asked me for a quick drink. He said, "Why don't you pop back and have a nip in the evening?" So I thought, great, great. So we leave campus. I'm driving in my Lincoln Continental 69 black top baby blue suicide doors, right? It was going down this road, going south. And then he then gets on to Sunrise and goes east. And that's a little odd because most professors either lived in the fashion west of the North Shore or they live in the city. So, but I wasn't terribly surprising because I knew my way there because I lived on this South Shore. And he gets on my exit. And I think, going back to my place to have a drink? How does he know where I live? So I was very confused for a bit, but I keep on following him to my place, and of course I discovered that we were in fact neighbours, completely by accident. We both lived on what he called the fashionable South Shore, which was his famous little sayings. So Dave was in some sense my boss that first semester, as he was teaching me to teach. And he was also, by some accident of nature, my neighbor. Certainly, he was a friend. He was an incredible force of nature. For the next 2 decades, I sat in his kitchen at least 3 times a week and learned to love scotch almost as much as he did. When I saw him just 2 days before he died, Mary confided in him, or he confided, but mentioned to me that apparently I'd made an image impact on him because he kept on telling her about this weird British TA grad student that was in the program. So we formed an instant bond. He was also, of course, not just my neighbor, my boss, my friend, but my teacher. And what a teacher he was. I remember learning his highly idiosyncratic Descartes, and again, this is, you know, and of course, it was mainly wrong, so you had to disagree with him. But he was always so wonderfully generous. I mean, he was great, wasn't wrong. There's two types of philosophy. There's wrong and interestingly wrong. Right? He was interestingly wrong, and the rest of us are just plain wrong. But so when you would disagree with any particular reading or particular passage, you say, that quite makes sense in the context. He was always wonderfully generous. I remember, you know, we had the history exams at comps, and he was never any fair that if you wrote a different Descartes, he was going to grade it, but sometimes he was going to go wrong, because you disagreed with him. Right? When you were one of his students, he would listen from your perspective, trying to think about what interpretive framework you were reading the text from. Any good teacher would listen to one correct interpretation of anything, right? He practiced that as well as preached it. So that Descartes course was wonderful. He was scheduled during the faculty meeting, so he never had to go to a faculty meeting. So that's midday on Wednesday, and the first thing we do when we got into the class was we get out the takeout menus and we'd order what was going to be delivered for the break. And there were 10 of us, it was a very small seminar, and 9 smoked, and 10 of us plus 10 smoking, including him. And I had this wonderful colleague, very, very great colleague, Thornton Tibbles, who was actually crying. Because he was the only one that didn't smoke, and just tears were running down his face because he was so smoky in the room that, you know, if you want a 2-pack a day smoker, it was you couldn't slide. So we opened the window. That was rather about Thornton. He was such a a mensch. He wasn't like, "I'm allergic to smoke." He just shut up and suffered it till someone was pointed out, "Maybe we should open a window." But anyway, so and then the last 5 meetings, there were 2 presentations by us on our term papers with respondents, right, which I think is much better than having people present early in the semester because you haven't learned enough to say anything early in the semester. And the only rule was that each person giving a paper had to bring a bottle of wine. So, you know, this is the last great European tradition of seminars. So, he was a boss, to some extent, a neighbor, a friend, and a teacher. He was also a mentor. Realistically, he worked with me more on my dissertation than did my director. And I guess more than anything else, I've always tried and utterly failed to live up to his standard of clear writing, as we mentioned. And right now, I can't resist passing on one anecdote, and it's a review, right? In some sense. So he'd been asked by his editor to write a blurb for a book on Nietzsche, which he did, very generously. It's very, very nice blurb. But this is the note that he sent to their shared editor. Dear, whoever it is, I looked over this person's manuscript. I am pleased with most of the entries. There is some variation of quality, but much of it is fascinating material. One of the shortcomings I should point out, and this leaps out of the introduction itself, is the reliance on faux technical lit crit gobbledygook vocabulary and syntax. Let me quote just three sentences from page 9 and see if you would allow this crap to get through editorial. Indeed, passed around the office for laughs. I quote, "This program requires an understanding of domesticity, a retranslation of homo natura as animal, an experimental willingness to psychosomatically transfigure oneself into a sublim, left parenthesis, AT, right parenthesis, E, left parenthesis, D, right parenthesis, embodiment of wilderness, double dash. It calls, in other words, for ubermensch of cultural zoology to act as feral philosophers." First sentence. "Ferity is then a liminal mode of human animality tapped by Nietzsche's product of biological naturalization in order to redeem humanity's animal foosis while avoiding the tame and wild extremes of civilized captivity and uncultivated barbarity." Okay, good. Don't think that one. "Thus, the transvaluatory maintenance of carnate animality throughout the spiritual overtures of cultural sublimination serves as a corrective for and a continuing check on the false evolution, consciousness manifested in what Nietzsche identifies as the era of homo hubristic hierarchy over their organisms." Yeah. The book is actually quite good. I mean, I've read the book. But yes, we all get kind of occasional sentences we wish we put a couple of pull stops in. So here comes Dave's comment. "Ferity. Indeed. This whole piece calls for a good, swift, transcendental deferrification. Please, please have someone who writes English, not anguish, touch up this turgid prose. Can you imagine someone reading that aloud? In any case, I am pleased to send all my blurb for the book. Hope it helps. Please feel what advice you like." So, you know, one's very generous, but occasionally he, you know, when he wants to be critical, he certainly would. And, you know, and he could be stern as a mentor, as my mentor. I will never forget his opening question as opening questioner on my dissertation. Right? This is the first one out of the game. I thought usually they lob an early one. Normally, the form is you just send one up so that hopefully somebody will knock it out of the park to get them to warm up. Right? Because you don't want somebody to panic, or you want to give them a little bit of confidence to get the thing going. Not Dave. He just said, "Why do you want to reify missingness?" My entire dissertation was about missingness, and it was my metaphor for our understanding of being. So, of course, the first thing is, if I was reifying it, my entire project was sunk from the get-go. Right? And that was just a, you know, not a how do you do, or by your way, or that was interesting, but just right out of the gate with a gut punch, boom. So, which is nice. It's like you want a mentor to stretch it, a mentor to be nice to you. So, he was a boss, a neighbor, a friend, a teacher, a mentor, but also a father figure. Or if we're going to have no nom du pair here, a parental unit. So, Dave and Ellen, both of them, were parents to Lisanne and I, who were away from Europe. Here and didn't really know anybody, and even perhaps even more to Lisanne than myself. But they, you know, Dave Leonard took us in. Obviously, being neighbours helped, but we were a member of that household family. I mean, I was there at the dining room table 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times a week. It seemed I would just come home from work and I'd just ring the doorbell. We'd have a glass of scotch. I'd go home, cook, and get on with some work and go to bed. So we could show up any time of the day or night unannounced. And they sometimes showed up, not less unannounced, any time of the day or night. So the hole that Dave leaves in my life is unimaginably huge. He's doing well now. Best friend, confidant, parent, mentor, than me. To finish, I'd like to say a few words about his peculiarities. What always struck me about him is he was just a ball of contradictions. He was an urbane New Yorker Parisian with a streak of Montana woodsman. It wasn't always obvious, but it was there. I once mentioned that to Ed Casey. Ed Casey leaped to his defense as if I was calling him, you know, Dave unsophisticated. I was like, no, it wasn't meant to be an insult. He was also had this woodsman to him, as well as this New York Parisian sophisticated. He could be a charming raconteur. All those stories I could hear again and again, I really wish I could hear again and again. He was wonderful with his students. Students creep me out sometimes when they come up to me like this. After what? They go away. Right, he had that warmth. He really, you know, they were so enthusiastic by him. But on the other hand, I've seen he could be agoraphobic. I remember going to Smith Haven Mall. I mean, you know, the mall's meant to be agoraphobic. It's a condition we probably all suffer from. But he was just like, he just was completely bugged out. I mean, it's the only way you could describe it. So again, all of these contradictions. He was as erudite and sophisticated as they come. But the last time I saw him, what we both knew was the last time we would ever see each other, it was 2 days before he died, the last thing he said was, BFF. You know, how millennial, how young, how with it. You know, if I try to behave like that, it would just people just look and say, you know. He was so natural and vivacious. So the very last thing I'd like to say, and it's the most wonderful because I've often found it a little troubling, is some of the things he would say in passing could only be described as anti-Semitic, racist, misogynist, and homophobic, right? Although not Dave could be all of those at once. And all those who knew him will know what I'm going to say. You know, sometimes you just hear it, Dave, you just can't say that. You know, even times a little bit reprehensible, at least difficult to stomach. You know, we put it down to being old school or being in jest. But I want to leave you with one last anecdote to put in perspective. We had a junior faculty at Stony Brook, I won't mention any names or give you the details, that was sexually harassed. And it was actionable without a doubt, right? I mean, this was not a minor issue, this was very, very, very serious. And all the petty moralists, of whom philosophy departments are packed, we have a great, never-ending supply of petty moralists in philosophy, were all running for cover, right? They wanted to sweep it under the rug. They wanted to say that, look, you know, you're a visiting faculty, you're on the market, if you, you know, create a fuss here, you'll never find a job, and, which, I mean, some of that's true, and some of that might have been as good a piece of advice, right? But it seems to be a little self-serving at the time, in the context. And Dave, and I think he was unique in this, or certainly unique in being this forceful, that said, screw them, put their balls to the wall. If you want to take action on this, I will back you wholeheartedly and unreservedly. Right? So, Dave, true to the existentialism he studied, a ball of contradictions, never bound by rules or mindless convention, when the chips were down, he would be there. Goodbye, and may your God go with you.
If are there remarks or questions from those here? If not, we can thank the panel for actually a wonderful session. Thank you, Vivette, for organizing this. Thank you all for coming.
There will be some remarks a little bit later if you want, because this is still a meeting of the Nietzsche Society. And I want to point out also, I had not known, and I have been trying to find out for years, who founded the Nietzsche Society. I knew that it was going before the Billy Joel movement started the fire, and I knew David, but I didn't actually know. Thank you for that bit of history, because one of the funny things about history, and you tend to find this out at death, is is that no one really had remarked on anything, and so there's all kinds of details that you made no mention of because they went without saying and so on. But this is very important for at least the Nietzsche society to know who its founder was, and of course I guess you're also part of that now, even if you're not saying so, you have to have, by definition, have been part of that. So I'm very grateful for being able to discover that answers that question, which I have been seeking for this time, so long. The founder of the Nietzsche Society, how did it start, where did it begin? And it's nice to know that it was with David, the co-editor of New Nietzsche Studies. We're still editing, we're still going to continue to produce. We haven't yet reached that new series stage of abyssal nothingness. We're still proceeding. And hopefully some of these essays will be there, some of the presentations and other things. So there will also be a subscription if your libraries don't subscribe. Do think about it. The print version is the cheapest by far. Anything electronic, only people who deal with physics magazines, journals can really deal with it. This, the print version, libraries don't even laugh at. And so all you need to do is ask your librarian to order it, and they will. You know, it's a funny thing about that. It's a nothing. Now, if they want electronic access, I don't have control of that. The powers of infinite money are. But if you do order it, if a librarian does want that electronic version, tell me, and with no extra charge, I'll happily add you, your librarian administration, and even you yourself if you ask to the mailing list, because that's actually enough. So thank you for your attention and for your time. Those subscription forms are not here, but they will be a little bit later around the conference. Hopefully folks will see them, and hopefully people will continue to subscribe to the issues we have forthcoming. The most recent issue is this one. We mentioned the Kant issue, and I want to mention that Joshua has an essay in here. And the most recent issue is actually Economy and Psychology, Parody, Kierkegaard, and Love, Heavens, and Festival Essays. So I read the most recent issue, and there is a 2016 issue that is currently in press. We're working on it slightly slowed down by